IVM.
Hello and welcome to this week's episode of the Edges and Sledges Cricket Podcast. This is DJ, your host for the week, and I've got with me Varun Garg, my co-podcaster all the way from Singapore. What's going on, man, Varun? How are you doing?
I'm good, man. Just enjoyed the weekend. Waiting to see cricket in 2 days or 3 days. I've been following the cricket post where they've got a countdown going on. 9 days, 8 days, 7 days. I believe we're just 3 days away now.
Yeah, it's absolutely incredible, man. It's going to start on the 8th of July, West Indies versus England. There's going to be live cricket back on our TV screens. So we can finally stop watching reruns of old cricket matches. But I mean, it's been a really interesting week in cricket, right? Suddenly, there's a lot of buzz that's starting up again. But let's start, Varun. I know we mentioned this briefly last week, but we're going to try and do a little bit of a social media roundup to start with. And where else to start with but the new DJ Bravo song, Varun, which you sent us. So let's talk through that first. What's going on there?
It's not a song. That's the only thing I have to say about it. It is not a song. So DJ, like I did with the last DJ Bravo song, I'm just going to play like 10 seconds of it for our viewers. And you can then tell me, is it a song or is it just words put together?
MS Dhoni number 7. MS Dhoni number 7.
3 minutes.
Helicopter, helicopter. Everybody do the helicopter. It's just genius. He's hit gold, man, with this.
I don't know.
He's SK word, gold.
He's hit, got the word thala in there. He's put in there that Dhoni has won every trophy for his nation. And yeah, it's just amazing, man. How does he do it? How does he come up with it? And then how does the world accept this as a song? It's just beyond me.
Because people like me, once we hear the song, we can't stop singing it. It gets stuck in your head, man. Helicopter. Helicopter. It's just brilliant. Anyway, let's not talk too much. What was the last one? Was it Asia?
Yes, it was something around Asia, yeah.
It was Asia, wasn't it? And then, of course, the champion song was viral.
Good. After that, it's fair to say his music career has been pretty downhill from there. But
listen, man, I quite like this song. And maybe it's just because I'm biased, because it's about the main man, MS Dhoni. But I mean, I quite like this song, but very interesting. So the other thing I wanted to mention on social media, Varun, and this came up last week, was there was the Pandya brothers challenging each other for the fitness. So they were doing what? Superman burpees.
Yeah.
What were they doing?
Superman push-ups, I think, like just the gym floor doing push-ups. And I mean, when you watch it, you really wonder what you're doing with your life, right? Because like I'm sitting on a laptop the whole day. So once in a while, maybe I'll do a few push-ups. These guys are basically going around their house.
But it's their job. Can you imagine them just going around their house? Like their parents just watch these guys do like Superman push-ups.
I'm just imagining them saying it's dinner time and them just heading to the dinner table like that. Them heading to the roof like that. Like it was incredible. So great athleticism from both of them. It did seem like a family kind of discussion to me. But then suddenly our India captain also decides to get in and be like, hey, I can't miss out on this. I'm going to one-up you. And so he did some sort of a clap, right? A front clap push-up.
Yeah. Okay, so while he was in the air. He claps while he's fully in the air and lands and then claps again and moves up and down.
So, so let's articulate that, right? So it's called a front clap flying push-up. Let's say that's what it's called. And then
like an STD, but anyway.
It doesn't stop there because then Hardik Pandya comes up with a back clap flying push-up.
And he tells the captain, I've already always got your back.
Yeah. And I'm like, what is going on? Like, I think everyone's just really bored. I mean, Hardik's got a baby on the way, but I think Kohli is just really bored. So I wouldn't be surprised in the next couple of days if you see a 360 clap flying push-up, right? Where Kohli is going 360 degrees in the air, landing, clapping. I don't know what's going on. I think these guys need to get back on the field.
I think he'll have to land on one hand, though, to up that.
Yeah, I think
basically. I didn't think you and Ashwin were particularly impressed by that, by the way, because you were like, Pandya's toes are not even leaving the ground.
Yeah, I don't know, man. We watched that video too many times. And That's what I'm saying. There's no cricket on. I'm just watching videos, listening to weird songs. I don't know what's going on anymore.
Yeah, we'll put links in the show notes, guys. So you should definitely check out those things to actually work out what we're talking about. But let's talk a little bit more about cricket, right? And we actually had a listener's tweet trigger Jared Kimber actually writing a full article on this. And it was Archit who tweeted into Kimber, and it was talking about MS Dhoni as a captain and him backing his gut instinct. And Jared Kimber actually wrote an entire article on this. So guys, please check out Jared Kimber's Substack. Very interesting. And Archit, of course, congratulations on actually inspiring Jared to write an article about how MS Dhoni's captaincy is not actually based on instinct, but is based on experience which feeds and is seen as instinct. A very interesting article, I thought. In particular, so just wanted to shout that out. But the other thing that's recently happened is that it's not been a great week for Sri Lankan cricket, right? I mean, you had the sports minister come out and claim that Sangha and Mahela and the whatever the World Cup final was fixed by Sri Lanka to allow India to win, and selection was all fixed, and Matthews didn't play, and Muralitharan was injured, and all of that stuff, and the probe, because they've got a match-fixing law in Sri Lanka, so it's actually a crime over there. There was a probe by the police and they dropped the probe. But the next day, and according to the Daily Hunt, which I'm not sure how legit it is, the next day, this guy has, the sports minister who's seeking re-election, by the way, has sent evidence to the ICC, apparently, about this. So I don't know whether this is true or false, but Varun, any thoughts on this match being fixed by a guy who actually scored 188 balls in that match, which I find being Mahela.
It feels very odd, DJ. I mean, you know, the other thing is Mahela and Sangha have both come out and said, question us as long as you want, ask us anything. There's no evidence about it. They then went in on, I think, Thursday this last week, and Sangakkar got interviewed for 8 hours. I don't know how long Jayawardene got interviewed for, but then it was released saying there is no evidence. So I think these guys were really upset, right? I mean, it's not enough that you lost the game and had to deal with that emotion in a final. Then you have to come out 9 years later and talk about how it wasn't fixed. I mean, to me, it's ridiculous, man. But
how do you even prove a negative, right? That's the point. How do you prove that it wasn't fixed?
Exactly, right? So I don't know what else to say. I know Aravinda De Silva was being questioned. I know Upul Tharanga as well. So like you said, it's not a great time to be a Sri Lankan cricketer or cricket fan.
Yeah, absolutely. But of course, there was also some political stuff that went on behind the scenes with the West Indies, where the coach, of course, had to leave the bubble because he had a funeral and a death in the family. So he had to leave the bubble, come back, self-isolate and do all of that stuff. And there, given the politics there, and very interesting. So guys, check out the Caribbean Cricket Podcast, which is a fan-run podcast like us, where they talk about this West Indies board guy who's come out and said Phil Simmons should be sacked for leaving the bubble, which I mean, I think that's just a shocking position to take. But there's more detail in the Caribbean Cricket Podcast. So guys, do check that out for sure. Meanwhile, Ashwin, who's not on this podcast today because he had a big Independence Day out celebrating America's Independence Day yesterday.
Or Trump's birthday, as I call it. But yeah.
Was it Trump's? Is it Trump's birthday? No, it's not Trump's birthday.
It's not at all, but yeah.
I would be quite weirded out if it was his birthday on the 4th of July. But anyway, Ashwin had a big 4th of July, so he's actually sleeping in as we record this. But he has been busy with that video of his dog, where yeah. Ashwin has actually, like, I have to say one thing though. So Ashwin emulated the Kane Williamson and Manus Labuschagne hitting the ball to their dog and the dog catching it. I have to say though, the dog's technique is pretty good, but Ashwin's catching, catching technique seems a little bit suspect, even with the tennis racket.
Yeah, I think Ashwin was just too excited, man. His dog's name is Oreo. And when Oreo took that catch, Ashwin, you could see the sheer joy on Ashwin's face. Like, he just lifted his arms as if he's won the World Cup or something. It was on a tennis court. He did hit it with the tennis racket. And I think what we really liked and what I pointed out in the video is that Oreo kind of overstepped, misread where the ball is going to go, but adjusted himself so well in the last minute that he took the catch. And yeah, it's just super fun, man.
Yeah, it was absolutely incredible. It's the same thing that Kane Williamson's dog did, right? They start going in one direction and then they adjust themselves. So brilliant. So that's on our Instagram and our Twitter. We'll put a link to that as well. But guys, the biggest news is that cricket is starting in 3 days. And even bigger news for me is that social cricket and club cricket is back on the cards from next weekend. So I have just signed up for my first game of the season. So very, very excited. I've just ordered some new spikes and like all of that stuff. So we're very excited. But cricket back on our screens, Varun. Have you put in your subscription to Sky or Star or whatever you need to get subscribed to?
Yeah, man. Like I said, everything is ready. Everything is ready and waiting. And the best part about time zones in Singapore is that when the game starts in England, it's probably late afternoon here, right? Probably 5, 6 p.m. And so you get the full 8 hours that you can watch. So I'm really looking forward to that.
Yeah, and you don't have to like sneak around watching it in office either, right?
Yeah, exactly. You're working from home and there's cricket on. I mean, yeah, it'll be good fun. But
sorry, did you say watching from home or working from home?
Watching from home. But I'm really looking forward to it, man. I'm especially looking forward to see Ben Stokes captaining this England team, right? Because Joe Root is out. I know there was a little bit of talk. Jack Leach is not in the team. Bairstow is not in the team. And so, honestly, if I can give you my two cents, I don't really care who's playing. I just want to watch the game.
Absolutely agree, man. I mean, I think we are really starved of cricket. And we, of course, put out a poll recently where, and we could probably do a whole episode on this about people's favorite format of cricket. And I think we should do a whole episode on which format people, because we've got 70% saying test cricket is their favorite format. And there's this whole chat about it's dying and stuff. So people have come up with some very interesting stuff. So watch that space. We will look into that. But for this week's episode, we have a very interesting interview lined up. I spoke a little while ago to a county cricketer called Josh Poisden. He has played for the England Lions. He's played for Yorkshire Cricket. He's a leg spinner. He's been mentored by Stuart McGill. He has bowled what is known as the ball of the 21st century, much like what Shane Warne bowled. So very, very interesting episode. We've also, and just before this, and this will release the week after this, so next Monday, we've also just recorded an episode with Monty Panesar, and it is an absolute cracker, Varun. Varun and I were on that because Ashwin is, of course, sleeping in, so poor boy has missed out on that. But yeah, lots of exciting stuff coming up on this episode as well as the next. So guys, stay tuned, and here's the interview.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to another awesome week on the IVM Podcast Network. If you're not following us on social media, please do. We're IVM Podcast on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. We'd like to thank our sponsors this week, Paytm Money and Intel. Their support makes this content possible. So, been a really exciting week on the network this week. We've had some really cool stuff. My old friend Vivek Lad was on Storytellers and Storytellers. Definitely do check that out. On Cider Set, we had Ashwin Sanghi on Thursday's episode. And Cyrus and myself did a cock and bull, just the two of us. That was fun as well on Monday. Do check that out. Masaba was on Advertising is Dead, which was another really, really strong episode from Varun. And on the sports front, both Edges and Sledges, Football Shootball had some really fun episodes. That's the football twaddle. Do check those out as well. And if you haven't been paying attention and you haven't been listening to Smile India in these times, I don't know why you aren't. It's the most uplifting show that you could listen to. It's a short, bite-sized piece of really positive things that happen in India. Do definitely check that out. And with that, let's get you back to your show.
This week, we've got a very special guest with us. It's Josh Poisden, England Lions, Warwickshire and Yorkshire leg spinner, and now podcaster on the Spin Badger podcast. Josh, welcome to the Edges and Sledges Cricket Podcast. Pleasure to have you on.
Cheers, DJ. Thanks for having me on.
Yeah, so Josh, you're a leg spinner, and we haven't actually spoken to a leg spinner previously on this show. It's a fairly esoteric art. There's a little bit of mystery and magic to it. So tell us a little bit about your early inspirations. I know you started life as a wicketkeeper. What made you switch to leg spin particularly? Because it's such a hard thing to do.
Yeah, that's good research already, DJ. So I guess I started playing cricket when I was really young. Like a lot of people used to go and, a lot of people's journey into the game used to go and watch my dad play and then kind of fell in love with the game. So yeah, I was kind of wicketkeeper first couple of years till I was about 12 and then, you know, always mucking around the nets like kids do. Started mucking around trying to bowl some leg spin, actually came out all right, so kind of stuck with it. And then in terms of early inspirations, like a lot of people my age, you know, watching Shane Warne on TV was massive. I think when I was that age, you know, 12, 13, 14 was when he was really in his pomp, so it was amazing to watch him and see someone, you know, potentially like the best bowler ever, to be, you know, for him to be doing his stuff when I was in my kind of formative years. I think was I was really lucky to be at that age when that was happening. But then, you know, there was other leg spinners around the world. Stuart McGill, who I'm sure we'll come on to later. He was doing well when he played for Australia. A massive impact on me was I grew up in Sussex, and it was when Mushtaq Ahmed played for Sussex. So, you know, I'd basically walk down from school and be able to go and watch him bowl spells, and it was amazing just to watch the kind of skill he had and the presence he had as a bowler. And, you know, he absolutely dominated when he played for Sussex. So I guess I was really lucky that I had, you know, on the international stage, I had Shane Warne to watch, and then, you know, like a 5-minute walk when I went to school, I could walk down the road and see Mushtaq Ahmed taking 100 wickets in a year for Sussex. So I guess, I was lucky to grow up where and when I did.
Incredible. And you've also been coached and been mentored by Stuart McGill, haven't you? So is he one of your role models too?
Definitely. Like, I think all spinners, and especially leg spinners, will always try and watch other leg spinners. So when I was growing up, I'd always watch Stewie bowl, and obviously just spun it an absolute mile. So it was always really entertaining to watch. And then back in 2016, I was out playing grade cricket in Australia on an ECB scholarship, and basically got the chance to start working with him. And, you know, he was, ever since then, really, he's someone who's had a really profound impact on my career. You know, whether that's, I think I've spent 3 winters in Australia when I've been working with him, and every time I feel like I've really improved when I've come back. You know, on top of that, now, like, he's a really good mate and mentor. Like, so even, you know, we're starting to get back into things over here. So I've been bowling the last couple of weeks, and I know that I can send him footage whenever, really, and he'll talk about my action, because, you know, it is such a unique skill that having those voices and people to talk to can be really important.
Absolutely. We were supposed to have him on the Edges and Sledges podcast, but we had some technical stuff go down and we couldn't get him on, which is an absolute shame, because we prepared a cracking episode for him with all his best stuff. But anyway, I'm sure we'll get him on later.
He's brilliant, but he can be a bit elusive at times. That's part of the brilliance.
It's part of the mystery and the aura, isn't it? Anyway, Josh, you talked a little bit about the ECB scholarship. Let's talk about how you made it through the first class system, because in India, it's quite straightforward. You've got a few Indian domestic competitions called the Ranji Trophy, the Dilip Trophy, the Irani Trophy. And now you've got the IPL. So those are your ways into first-class cricket and even test cricket in some cases. But maybe you could give our listeners a brief overview of how cricketers actually make it through the English system to play first-class cricket, like you.
Definitely. So I think, right, there's probably 2 ways of looking at DJ. So it's probably like the normal route, which would be, so you've got your 18 first-class counties that play in, you know, the county championship, so the equivalent of the Ranji Trophy, and obviously the white ball competitions. And those teams will have, you know, second teams that have academies, and the vast majority of homegrown players that come through would have been on the academy since 14, 15, because they're always really talented, you know, get all that brilliant help that they can get through the system, and, you know, hopefully progress into the second team and the first team, and then, you know, onto, you know, hopefully international cricket in some cases. So I think that's probably the main route. But then alongside that in England, there's a scheme that has previously been run by the MCC called the MCC Universities Scheme. And that's now actually about to switch back to the ECB, are going to be in control of it. Basically how that works is around England and Wales, there's 6 centres. And so each centre might have 2 or 3 universities affiliated to it. So in my case, I went to Anglia Ruskin University, which is in Cambridge. So we also had Cambridge University. We're affiliated with the centre, which made Cambridge MCCU. So we basically, it was basically the reason I decided to go to university there, was because I knew that it gave me 3 years to train full-time. They've just stopped it this year. It was going to be the last year, but you actually played first-class games. So as a student, I played first-class cricket for Cambridge MCCU. That's how I made my first class debut. And then that's kind of...
scoring 47 runs and taking 3 wickets, I might add.
Yeah, that was actually my second game. But
was
yeah.
it? Okay.
After my, so
research
after,
fail.
No, but after my first year at uni, like, because as a 18, 19-year-old, I was nowhere near good enough to be playing county cricket. So to be playing first class cricket was a bit of a novelty anyway, let alone, you know, doing all right in one of the games. So I remember, like, just having some banter mates. I remember, like, my stats after my first year. Like I said, I was averaging 47 with a bat, so definitely getting a bit ahead of myself, thinking I was the next Jack Callis, but not to be. But, Yeah, but you know, so this basically this whole MCCU scheme gives players the chance to, if they're not quite good enough to play county cricket and get a contract when they're 18, they can go away, have this kind of different training and playing set up. But at the same time, you know, something that's really important for cricketers in England and I guess around the world is making sure that you have, you kind of set yourself up for life after cricket. So it gives you the chance to also study and get a, you know, a proper degree when you're playing cricket, which was massive for me because at the time, you know, I was blindly just like loving cricket, just going for it, going for it. But I think actually the chances of me progressing through and becoming a professional cricketer was actually pretty small. So to know that I always had that to fall back on if it didn't work out then, and especially down the line when I stopped playing professional cricket, I do have that degree in the bank. Like it is a really brilliant, special scheme. And I hope that I really hope that it kind of stays as strong as it has been previously. And I, you know, but at my side, we had, you know, Zafar Ansari was at Cambridge Uni. He started the same year as me and he went on to play for England in like maybe his first or second year out of uni. So it really was a solid platform for cricketers to kick on and go and achieve things in the game.
Well, that's incredible because we had Jayadeva Nutkut, who's an Indian cricketer as well. And one of the things he emphasised for young cricketers was make sure you're doing well on the study side of things because it allows you to play more cricket. Definitely. And that it's interesting that you've come up with that. I think the trouble in India a lot of the time is it's either cricket or studies. And it's almost impossible with the amount of competition there for you to keep those up. Of course, you have exceptions. You have lots of cricketers with engineering degrees. I think VVS Lakshman, I read his book, was doing a medical degree, which is quite hard to do with a full-time cricket career. He thought of going back to it when he was 35, is what he said. But interesting that you made it through the university's route, because I'm not sure that actually exists in other countries in the world, because I don't know whether that scheme is around in other countries. So that, no, I think that's particularly interesting.
I don't think there's a formal scheme. You know, I know speaking to mates in Oz who have gone on to play Big Bash or whatever, they kind of just do degrees off their own backs, but there's no formal scheme. And, you know, I think in India, like, it's a different, like, it's so competitive, like, everyone wants to play cricket, so maybe...
Everyone wants to be Kohli now. It's not just play cricket.
Exactly, yeah, you know, so it lends itself to that you know, complete, you know, almost obsessive practice from, like, 7, 8, even younger, you know, people in the nets all day, every day. And I think, you know, even, like, spent... I had a couple of trips to India and you see it, you just see it's just relentless, the desire and the effort all the young players have, which is brilliant. But you know, it's a really tricky balance between, do you go all in because that might give you the best chance, or do you think about if it might not happen? It's a really tricky conversation. Not, you know, on a completely unrelated topic, I was listening to a podcast yesterday with Adam Scott, the Australian golfer, and he was saying exactly the same thing. You know, it's, do you give yourself no alternative, so you have to be brilliant at your sport, or do you go down the more sensible route of giving yourself a plan B so that if things don't happen, you know, you have a second career to fall back on? It's a really hard conversation, I think.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, there's only, 20 people that play for the country at any given time at the sport. And, I mean, it's just an impossible choice for every Kohli or Hanuma Vihari or Ravi Jadeja. You've got, I don't know, thousands, maybe tens of thousands of people who are equally talented, equally good, just didn't get the right break or score runs in one game which mattered with the selector sitting there. So it's,
yeah, and there's so much luck in it, right? Like, again, if I flip back on my career, like, there's so many little things that you, at the time, you just think it happens. But if it didn't happen, you know, you wouldn't end up getting to where you get to. So it is, you know, you obviously have to work really hard to put yourselves in those situations, but there's also a lot of luck involved. And that's, you know, England, India, throughout the world, you know, I really think that it is really competitive to get to the kind of professional level. So, you know, you can work as hard as you want, but you also need those little breaks as you go along.
Can you tell us a little bit about some of those little breaks that you can think of that come to mind? A catch that was taken or a brilliant slip catch or a run out or some runs you got in a crucial game which mattered? Is there anything that comes to mind particularly?
Yeah, probably not loads of runs, DJ.
Despite your average of 47.
Yeah, well, not anymore. but yeah, I think, like, for me, a couple of really big things that happened were, say even when I was 18, I went, you know, I mentioned I'd spent 3 years working with Stewie. I've actually spent a lot of other years playing in Sydney. So when I was 18, I was playing second-level club cricket in England, so, you know, no real standard of any note. And I went away and played in Australia and worked me up the grades, and I came back and I was just net bowling at Sussex. And, you know, there was an injury, which meant I played in the second team, which probably gave me a bit of motivation to kick on and decide to go to uni. So there's one, you know, at uni, there was a scheme called the Unicorns, a team that used to play in the county one-day competition for a couple of years. And it just so happened that when I was at my last year at uni, when I'd kind of got myself to a decent level, they were still playing in the one-day competition. It was their last year. And I got the opportunity to trial for them, ended up playing. And, you know, I think I played the first couple of games and had a bad finger break. So I missed the majority of the season, but came back and had some really good games. And it turned out that the head coach of the Unicorns was a scout for Warwickshire. So that was, you know, a really lucky break. And then also, even when I was at Warwickshire, you know, there was another really good mate who was at Cambridge with me. So it was me, Zafran Soane, and then Paul Best, who had captained England 19s. He was at Warwickshire as well, and he got injured, which meant that I got my opportunity. And then he got injured again, which meant that I got a contract. So, you know, there's loads of little things, and you reflect on it and you think, oh, if that hadn't happened, would I still be in the game? Like, it's a really tough thing. But I guess, you know, the main message to any young cricketers is that you can't control any of the luck. What you can control is making sure that you really enjoy your cricket and really work hard so that you put yourself in that shop window constantly, and you're constantly putting yourself out there.
Incredible. Just like MS Dhoni says, control the controllables.
Exactly, yeah.
Very sage advice. So Josh, but you've done really well. You've, of course, played for Warwickshire. You've also played for Yorkshire. And your crick info profile says that you're not a big turner of the ball, which I found particularly interesting. So I'll put up the link to your crick info profile. But what I will also put up the link to is what people are calling the ball of the 21st century. Josh, tell us more about that, because you're a leg spinner. Of course, you had Shane Warne bowl to Mike Getting in 1990, his first ball in the Ashes. And people have likened that delivery you bowled to Shane Warne. Talk us through the setting. Talk us through what you felt before you bowled that and what you felt after that ball had gone down.
Yeah, well, I think, like, first of all, from that quick info, I think it was George LaBelle who wrote that. And, you know, he's a very tough kind of journalist, so like, my opinion is probably, that's probably on the harsh side of things, but you know, like, everyone's entitled to their opinion, but I think that actual day was a bit of a funny time in my career. Like, so I'd signed for Yorkshire about 6 weeks previously from that, but because I was still playing for Warwickshire in T20 until that finished, I got told by Yorkshire that they wanted to keep it quiet until close to the time when I was going to join. So, you know, I was kind of keeping it hush. I hadn't really told anyone that I'd signed. And I got a text that morning saying from the Yorkshire director of cricket saying, mate, we're going to announce that you're signing for Yorkshire tomorrow. You know, these are your last couple of games for Warwickshire. See you at the weekend kind of thing. And I was thinking, right, well, here we go. And I knew the game was on TV. And county cricket is very different to the IPL, and that not every game's on TV. So whenever you do play on TV, it's obviously a really big opportunity to showcase your skills. So not only do I want to do well, you know, obviously I really wanted to go out on the high for Warwickshire. That was my main motivation. I knew it was on TV, so people were watching, but I also knew in the morning it was being announced that I signed for Yorkshire. So I had that kind of motivation to really kind of put in a performance to set my stall out to the Yorkshire, everyone at Yorkshire basically. So I'm thinking, all right, I'm going to do well tonight. And then, yeah, it was a nice spinning wicket, which is always helps. And yeah, I guess, like, for me in T20, I think I don't really change how I bowl too much. Like, you look at someone like Shahal, and he's very skillful when he bowls in the power play. He can shut off certain areas of the ground. He's got that brilliant ball he bowls when he bowls really wide. For me, I don't really change too much. I just try and bowl my best ball every ball, because I know if I get it right, it's going to be the hardest ball to bowl. So I probably bowl a bit similar to how I would in Red Bull cricket. So yeah, so like I said, just try my best ball. And yeah, just that one in particular came out lovely. And then I actually, like, because I knew it was coming out the next day when we finished the game, you know, we won, which was brilliant. But you know, I basically had to tell the lads and all the Warwickshire lads that I played with for 5 years after the game that I was leaving. So it was just a bit of a, I guess, a funny time. And then, you know, the next day my phone was going mental anyway because of this ball that I bowled, but also at the same time Yorkshire were just releasing that I'd signed for them. So it was a pretty pretty busy 24 hours, I guess.
I think what made it the ball of the 21st century was also the batsman's reaction. Croft, yeah. I think, was the batsman, and he just looked exactly like Mike Getting. Like, Mike Getting couldn't quite believe it either, could he?
Yeah, or maybe he'd been reading my cricket info profile, so I probably didn't believe it.
We'll tag George in the tweet when it goes out. I'm sure.
Oh, I don't know about that. Don't want to get on his bad side.
Awesome, Josh. So that is incredible. We'll obviously put a link to the ball of the 21st century in the show notes. So make sure you watch that. But Josh, just moving on to one of our favorite topics. We're called Edges and Sledges. Of course, you like the edges, but if they aren't coming, do you bring out your sledges?
I don't.
Your sledger.
I don't think that's really in my character. So I think a really important thing for any cricketer is like being authentic and that being true to yourself. And I'm not really someone who's going to spray the bat out. You know, I like to kind of stay in my own bubble and let the ball do the talking. So I think if I am sledging someone, they've either really done something that's annoyed me or they're probably winning the battle. So I'm more likely to kind of stay in my own shell. So I haven't really given out too much. And then, you know,
when you have, Josh, what have you given out, and who's been your sledging opponent? Because we love these sledging stories. The best bits are with the cricketers just going off at each other, because it starts from club level but goes all the way.
I don't really know, to be honest. Like I can't recall something that I've said that was, you know. I think like I always enjoy it when you play against mates, and it's not, you're not really going to sledge them in a bad way. It's probably just a little smile or. Yeah.
So if you're not a sledger, have you been sledged a lot? Because if you stay in your own bubble and you've played a lot in Australia, I'm assuming you've got some, and you're a fan of the great cricketer. In fact, I got introduced to the great cricketer through you. So tell us about the Aussies sledging you if you haven't been sledging them back.
Yeah, well, I guess that is a exception. Like, I think as my club, Northern Districts, that I played for the last two times I've been there, I remember I went in as night watchman for them in one game, and like it was, you know, you've been fielding for 90 overs in 40 plus degrees, and then you have to go and do the opening batter's job and bat for four overs, and you've got basically just 11 blokes who just want to absolutely spray you. So that was pretty entertaining. But I almost think like the Aussie thing is just funny. Like it's just like a cliche, like how hard they'll come at English players. So you just got to laugh at it, really. Like I said, and again, batting down the order, probably I haven't spent loads of time there to be sledged, but yeah, it's just pretty funny. And you just, you know, you have a laugh with your batting partner and stuff, you know, like, or the classic thing for me playing Australia is obviously, you know, got your Yorkshire helmet, whatever. So you obviously don't want to bat in your Yorkshire helmet. So you put a plaster over it, and like lads just love jumping on that. Like, oh, why are you covering up? And there's not even a badge there. Like, how have you got a contract? Like all that kind of stuff that you just have to laugh about. Like, and I think Aussies in particular, like they get very, you know, they're very fond of their grade cricket. And like, you know, I remember being at training and speaking to like second or third graders, and they're saying, oh, so, you know, what's county cricket like? Is that like the equivalent to like second grade here? And you're thinking like, no, like pretty sure like Marnus, like Labuschagne's not coming over and playing second grade here, mate. So like it is a bit different, but I guess that's just your the Aussies kind of mindset. But, you know, I've really loved, I'll try and claw it back a little bit, DJ, and say, you know, I have loved all my time in Australia and playing there, and it has been a massive influence on me as a cricketer.
I'm sure it was fun, but there's some pretty good stories there. Which anyway, Josh, tell us a little bit about the role of your captains in managing you, because we're always told that it's all about managing leg spinners, that they're seen as these kind of unicorns that need to be wrapped in cotton wool and just brought out at the magical moment. Well, I mean, someone like Warren, for example, has been pretty hard on Steve Waugh. I mean, even recently he was tweeting about Steve Waugh and how he left him out of the team 20 years ago in the West Indies and how that was wrong. And I mean, we've obviously seen Kohli manage his leg spinners. We've seen Dhoni manage leg spinners, and different captains manage leg spinners differently. So what is the role of managing leg spinners for a captain, and what kind of management style would you particularly enjoy?
Well, I think the first thing is like you don't want special treatment, because as soon as you get that, after a while you start questioning like if the captain's being authentic and they mean it, or they're just saying it because they want to be nice. Like, so I think that's one. I also think it's really, really important for their leg spinner to manage themselves. They've got to know what fields they want. They've got to know what field suits their bowling. That's like a really important thing. Like, it is a very unique skill, and that's not the captain's fault, but it's up to me to say, this is the field I want. This is the field that I think's right. And then obviously you can have that discussion with the captain. And I think it just depends on where your leg is at. Like, I'm sure Kohli and Chahal, I'm sure there's a lot of discussion between them. You know, Chahal's now a very experienced and successful international cricketer, so he probably has a good idea and they can bounce ideas off each other. Like, I know the best captains I've played under, there's that kind of constant conversation, like in between overs, what do you think about this? You know, involving the wicketkeeper, and that's really important. You know, they're seeing it from the batter's view, so they can talk to you about your bowling, but also your fields. You know, they get really, especially at the angles of the fielders, keepers can be really important. But I guess for me personally, like, the style of management that I've responded well to in my career is that consistency. So you know where you stand, you know what your role is, you know what you need to do. Like, I think probably the two best captains, potentially, or two of the best captains I've had, I've played some really good ones, is probably right at the start of my career when I was a bit more inexperienced. We had Varun Chopra at Warwickshire, and he's been a very successful side, and it was just everyone knew what they were doing when. So say in a T20, I'd only be playing my third or fourth game, but I knew as soon as the power play was up, I was going to get chucked the ball. My field was really simple. I either had 2 points and no mid-wicket or 1 point and mid-wicket. That was the only thing that changed. You know, nothing fancy. And then if I bowled well, I bowled my four overs straight through, and it was simple as, and I really knew where I stood. And then, like, I think now, but you know, it's not just the tactical side of it, it's the support and the communication. Like, I think, you know, since I've been at Yorkshire, I've had a couple of injuries that have been really annoying because I wanted to just get out there and play. But the captain here, Steve Patterson, is absolutely brilliant at the communication side of it. You know, even if, you know, last year I left out for a championship game, straight away, conversation, ring me a couple of days later, check I'm okay. Same with the injuries. Like, and I think so, it's that genuine care that you want from a leader for you, and it really makes, you know, so I guess probably a combination of that and the consistency, yeah, Chopra gave me. But I think that at the same time, like, it's really important. You know, we are different to a lot of cricketers, but we don't want that special treatment. Like, leg spinners, especially on the tactical side, they have to know what fields they want and almost have that template and then work from there.
Very interesting, because we almost see sometimes on television, and obviously we're not out there on the field, you can see MS Dhoni actually dictating to Kuldeep what to bowl in Hindi, because we follow that. But it's incredible, because from what it sounds like, leg spinners almost set their own field, is what you're telling me. But for the wicketkeeper to have that insight from behind the wicket, I thought was particularly interesting. So if Kuldeep's come through the ranks setting his own field, and then he suddenly got someone like MS behind the stumps for him, I think that's just incredible.
Yeah, that's probably a really hard dynamic, because, you know, Dhoni is amazingly experienced, and you only have to look at his success as a captain, you know, everything, to know he's obviously massively successful. But I think it would take a certain type of bowler to, you know, you're not dictating what you're doing, someone else is doing it. Like, personally, I wouldn't enjoy that. I'd rather be in control and, you know, do it on my terms. But at the same time, like, if you had someone that good, then, you know, you've obviously got to, you know, listen to them. So it is a tricky one. But I think as well, like, the difference between, this is probably more on coaching than captaincy, but the difference between England and India, like, whenever I've been in England, the coaching's always been, you know, I've worked with some brilliant coaches here, but it's been, you know, very rigid about your technique. And then you go to India and you work with people. So I worked with, when I first went, a guy called Vinay Dandigar, who played first-class cricket, leg spinner in Pune, and he was brilliant. Like, he basically taught me how to bowl googly that I couldn't do, and obviously for leg spinners, that's really important, and the kind of the methods that he used to help me bowl it was something, you know, stuff that I hadn't really heard over here. And then when I went last winter, I went to Mumbai and worked with Sairaj, who works for Rajasthan.
Bautale, the...
Sairaj
Bautale, Mumbai leg spinner, played for India
in the late 90s.
Yeah.
And he was brilliant. But I went, you know, last year I went when I was 27. And before, when I went, I was 19. So it was a very different stage in my career. But Sairaj was brilliant on the really finer points of leg spin bowling, you know, like different tactics, you know, bowling different paces, very fine technical points. So I think that's probably something else that's really important for a leg spinner, and something I always try and preach is try and listen to those different voices and pick what information works for you.
Very interesting. So now that we're on the Indian leggies, let's talk a little bit about our favorite Kuldeep and Chahal. We call them Kulcha lovingly for just ease of reference.
Yeah.
But they've had their troubles of late. I mean, and it started really from the England versus India game in the 2019 game, where Jason Roy and Johnny Bairstow basically took them both apart at the start. They clawed their way back, to be fair. I mean, the last four overs, I think Kuldeep bowled only went for about 20, which is not bad enough. A fairly high scoring game, but that's the short boundaries comment. Yes, that's the one short boundary. But Kuldeep also then got dropped from the Test side. The last Test he played, he'd taken five wickets. So in the Sydney game, so. What are your thoughts on the two Indian leg spinners? I mean, before the World Cup and before we started playing Jadeja, who's a finger spinner, they were the golden ticket to India's World Cup hopes. They were attacking, taking wickets in the middle overs, and they'd won games previously, which we had no business winning, just because of the skill that they brought to those middle overs by taking wickets. But ever since that happened, we've only played one of them along with the more safe option in Jadeja with his batting skill as well. So what are your thoughts on those two leggies? Well, one's a left arm wrist spinner, but...
I think, first of all, like, from my personal selfish point of view, like, it's brilliant to watch those two bowl. I think, you know, whenever there's one wrist spinner on a side, it's exciting. So to see two going about their work is brilliant. So I always try and watch when India playing. I was in New Zealand this winter when they're playing the series out there, so, you know, managed to watch a bit of that, and it's always interesting to learn from them. So I think that, you know, the first thing is it's brilliant that India have got those two spinners, and there's obviously actually a lot on their heels, isn't there? You know, a lot of wrist spinners are doing well in the IPL. I actually netballed at India A this winter. I can't remember the leg spinner who was there, but it was very, very good. So there's a lot of spinners on their heels, but yeah, I guess it's a hard one. Like, I think for Kuldeep, like, you know, it's obviously really hard to get a fifer and not get picked for the next Test match. But there's, as a wrist spinner, especially in Red Bull cricket, sorry, you know, there's a lot of stuff that's out of your control. So, did they play two spinners at Sydney? I can't remember that Test.
Yeah, so they did play two.
Yeah, you know, but I don't know where the next Test was. The next Test in New Zealand.
Well, the next Test would have been in India.
Yeah.
And well, so it was Ashwin and Jadeja, all the old firm was back together.
But you know, there's a lot of stuff that can be out of your control, and you know, there's probably other cricket happening in between. So it is really tough. But you know, I think they're both brilliant bowlers. Like, for me personally, I really, really enjoy watching Chahal bowl. I think we've got he's obviously world class, but I think we're kind of a little bit similar bowlers in how we go about it. You know, he really attacks the stumps, which is something I love to do. So I really try and watch him, and I don't know if you've noticed, recently he's done a few articles on Cricket Info talking about a lot of specifics about how he bowls, and I really have read those and, you know, highlighted a lot of stuff that I thought was really on point. So, you know,
yeah, I'm going to go to Cricket Info and read that. I've just been following him on TikTok, where he's been fairly...
He did a video as well on Cricket Info that I haven't watched yet, but I've got saved to watch. But I know he's an interesting character. Like, we had Chris Wokes at Warwickshire when I was there, who had obviously played with him at RCB. And, like, you know, I was asking him, what's Chahal like? He's always want to know, like, what, you know, obviously what their banters as bowlers, but also, well, like you said, he's like just a massive character. So I thought it was, you know, really interesting to hear about him. But I think, yeah, you know, like I said, based off India, really lucky to have those two spinners. I remember watching Chahal come on the scene in that T20 against England, and he just absolutely cleaned up. And then also Kuldeep at Trent Bridge a couple of years ago, bowling really well. So, you know, obviously, like you said, they've had their time when they've done really well. So I guess not from England's point of view, but for a wrist spinner's point of view, you know, hopefully they can keep doing really well.
Interesting. So interesting that Chahal hasn't actually played red ball cricket for India as yet.
Yeah, well, like, I don't know what Chahal's first class record's like, but I just think, you know, in general, like, I don't think there's a reason why he can't play Test cricket. I just think in general, like, T20 sets itself up better for wrist spinners just by the nature of the game. But, you know, obviously Ashwin is a amazing bowler. We're supposed to have him coming over to play for Yorkshire this year, so it's a real shame that with everything that's going on, that didn't happen, because not only would it have been amazing from the club's point of view to have such a brilliant performer you know, play for Yorkshire and hopefully put in some really good performances. But everyone I've spoken to about Ashwin from when he played at Notts or Worcester said that his kind of the help he provides to the young spinners is absolutely top draw. So it's a real shame that he couldn't come over and couldn't learn from him. But, you know, hopefully in future years, the club can try and get him over.
Brilliant. So we're going to move on from the Indian leggies and go to the world leggies. We're going to go across the world. So we've got a few good ones playing at the moment. I'm going to just ask you to pick your top three out of this list. I don't want to put you on the spot too much.
Yeah. Well, you can there, DJ. It's going to be hard. Yeah.
So we've got Rashid Khan, of course, the Afghanistan leg spinner. We've got Yasir Shah, who has got Steve Smith out a few times, who himself is a leg spinner. Adil Rashid, I think he's still at Yorkshire, isn't he?
Yeah, teammate.
Yeah.
He's obviously number one.
Yeah, yeah. Yuzi Chahal, Kuldeep Yadav, Shadab Khan, and Ish Sodhi. Now, so the list is Rashid, Yasir, Adil, Yuzi, Kuldeep, Shadab, Ish.
Yeah, well, I think there's a few different ways to go about doing a top three. It's going to be hard. I think, first of all, like, I think leg spin's a real brotherhood and it's, you know, everyone helps each other. And I touched on that, you know, speaking to different leg spinners is massive for me. So last year when the World Cup was on, I spent some time with Rashid Khan. He was amazing with his time. We've got Adil Rashid at Yorkshire. We played about 4 or 5 one-day games together last year, which was awesome. Like, it was so cool to have two leg spinners in the same team. So I put him there, and then it showed he's like a bit of a mate, like from when played against him, and you know
he was on your podcast recently.
So you know, I'm gonna have to go for the three people I've met, but at the same time, like that's probably from a mate's point of view. Like I think there's some brilliant leg spinners out there. I think, like I said, I'm a massive fan of the two Indian wrist spinners, the two Pakistani leg spinners. You know, have had a lot of success. I think. Yeah, so Shah's had a lot of success in test match cricket, which has been brilliant to watch because I think that is the hardest form to kind of do well in. So to see the success he's had, you know, not just in Dubai or UAE, but actually when he's come over to England, he's bowled really well. So, you know, everyone's got their own little things. Even, you know, Adam Zampa in Australia, like, he's probably not the most glamorous leg spinner. He's actually probably, going back to the cricket info profile, he's probably quite similar to me. He's not, on a non-wicket, he's not a big spinner of the ball, but gets a lot of shape in the air, really good googly, attacks the stumps, and I think
got some good players out.
He's brilliant at what he does. Like, it's, you know, like, again, like I try to, he's pretty simple, but he does it really well. And you only have to see, you know, when he played in the IPL, he got that sixth, was it? You know, he got, you know, consistently does well for Australia. So that googly ball to Kane Williamson in probably the last three games for a while. That was awesome. Like, and you know, he got picked up in the 100. Like, there's a lot of he's obviously very sought after. So I think he's brilliant at what he does and probably doesn't get as much, you know, credit as he should.
Yeah, I didn't have him on the list. So thanks for calling that out. Yeah. No, he's a good bowler. I mean, he's got Kohli out, I think, the most number of times amongst spinners. So I should have had him on the list. So that is my mistake. So thanks for pointing out.
I think I got out of that without doing a crystal.
Yes, so quite imagine. Diplomatic. Well done. Quite diplomatic. So well done. Josh, let's talk a little bit about the future of leg spin, right? So you've got all this T20 cricket and leggies are doing really well in T20 cricket. You look at the rankings, it's full of wrist spinners. So what is the future of this art, leg spin?
I think, like, it's a good question. I'll take the future, but I think from a shorter form point of view, like, I really think they're going to go strength from strength to strength. Like, the format in T20 and 50 over cricket really suits wrist spinners who have got a bit of mystery about them. And I think something you might see is what has happened the last 5 or 10 years is you get leg spinners who actually perform different roles. So you have to look at like Chahal or Badri for two bowlers who have been like exceptional in the power play. And then, you know, you have bowlers who bowl more in the middle who have had a lot of success, which is probably the more traditional role. But, you know, even bowlers, leg spinners are bowling at the death now and doing well. Like I said, Zampa, when he got that six for, Dhoni obviously likes bowling a leggy at the end. You see it in the Big Bash a little bit. Like, so I think it's really exciting that spinners can now bowl at different phases to what suits them. Like, you know, and so I think that's really exciting. You know, one thing I really hope is that because the leg spinners have been so successful in short form cricket, they're not forgotten about in longer form cricket. I do think they have a massive role to play there. And I think that's up probably to each leg spinner to really have that desire to play Red Bull cricket. And I think that it's easy to get pigeonholed as a leg spinner, someone who bowls a lot of bad balls. So especially in England, where traditionally spinners might do a holding role, you know, there's no reason why leg spinners can't do that. Like, you know, Warne was probably one of the most accurate bowlers ever, and he was a leg spinner. So, you know, there is real scope to do that. And then also, you know, the mystery we have, you know, we can clean up tail enders quickly, hopefully, you know, all that kind of stuff. There's a lot of, I think there's a big role for leg spinners in long form cricket as well. So I hope going forward that happens. And, you know, there is, like you said, there's wrist spinners playing long form cricket around the world. Someone who's a really good mate of mine and came on the podcast for the first episode is Matt Parkinson. And, you know, he's in England's Red Bull squad at the moment. So hopefully he can get a game soon and really show what, you know, leg spinners can do in the long form. So I think, you know, hopefully it's exciting. There's a lot of brilliant leg spinners around. And I think, you know, although kind of the generation who grew up watching Warne is probably kind of, most of them will be in the game now. You know, there's going to be this next generation of people who have watched all the successful T20 spinners who have probably been a bit more unique. People like Rashid Khan, you know, who have these different actions. So I think it's really exciting to see what types of unique bowlers come into the game.
Yeah, and the other person I've missed on my list is actually Tabrizi Shamsi from South Africa.
Yeah.
Another left-arm wrist spinner. Which,
he's definitely number one in celebrations, I think.
Yeah, is that the magic one?
Yeah, the magic one. I don't know if I've got that in the locker this year, but yeah, that was pretty entertaining.
I think that is the top. Imran Tahir had some pretty good
celebrations. Yeah, he's amazing. Well. And he's a brilliant, brilliant guy. Like, he... you know, he always has shared information with me whenever I spoke to him. I remember I was once net bowling at South Korea in Sydney, and he basically like missed the team bus to stay, show me this new ball in the indoor school. So he's a brilliant guy and obviously had a massively successful international career. But yeah, you know, there's loads of brilliant leg spinners out there at the moment.
That's awesome, Josh. Great. So we're coming to the end of our allocated time, but I want a couple of things. One, I'm going to do a rapid fire with you. So it's not going to be a long rapid fire with 20 questions. It's going to be five. So we're going to do that. And then we'll talk a little bit about your plans. I know you had a little bit of an injury scare last year. And so we're just going to talk about what next for you. But going to the rapid fire, the first one is, it's actually not rapid fire. It's actually a question which you can just answer in one word or two. If you had to take one wicket between these two, which one would it be? Smith or Kohli? I'm basically asking you to choose between the two.
That is a good question. I think I'll go... Obviously, it depends on the situation. If it was in the Ashes last year, it would be Steve Smith all day. But I think at the same time, if you got Kohli out, I think the world probably stands up and takes notice. So I'll go, if it's in the Ashes, Smith, if not, Kohli.
Oh, wow. Really? Are you the lawyer?
Well, no, look, there might be a bit of training from my other half from the last 5 or 6 years. Starting to play off.
Very diplomatic. Very diplomatic. Warne or McGill? This is going to test you as well.
I'm going to go McGill just because of the massive impact that he's had on my career. And, you know, I actually met Warne during 2015 Ashes, and he was brilliant with his time. But, you know, the relationship that I've got with McGill over a long period of time, and he's just basically a great mate. So, McGill, I'm going to go there. Not sitting on the fence for once.
Awesome. Blast or BBL? If you're contractually obliged to answer in a certain way, that's fine.
I think that's... Obviously, I've been really lucky to play in the Blast, and it's brilliant atmosphere over here, but spending a lot of time in Sydney and, you know, with my other half being Australian, I'd absolutely love to play in the Big Bash one day. You know, Sydney's a place where I've spent a lot of time. So to play for one of the Sydney teams in the Big Bash would be awesome. So I'll go for that.
I didn't put the IPL on because, I mean, that's clearly the superior competition amongst all of those. But we hope to see you there as well, Josh. Honestly, well, nice. It would be great to see you there.
Maybe we'll have to get Kohli out a few times and then maybe one day.
Well, if you get him out a few times, you might not actually make it to the IPL.
Yeah, well, I guess that rules one team out anyway.
That's it. That's the RCB. And the last one is actually red ball or white ball cricket. And I think that brings me neatly onto your future plans. And you had a freak injury last year in the nets as well. So what next for Josh Poyston?
like I said, I'm a real believer that leg spinners have a role to play in all three formats. So, and for me, like, there's no, at this stage in my career, there's no point in choosing like red or white ball, because at the moment I can do all of them, which is brilliant. And I think that for me personally, if you gave me, let's put it this way, DJ, like, if you gave me the chance, I can only do one training session, do I want to bowl a red ball or white ball? I'll always bowl a red ball, because that's your basic skill. You know, that honing of your stock ball is what's going to be your go-to in all forms of cricket. So, you know, white ball's brilliant, and going forward, you know, that's probably something that I think if you look at my record, I probably had equal success in all three formats, but I think that a lot of people probably see me more as a white ball bowler, which I would argue, but, you know, I get that being a leg spinner. So I think, you know, white ball is brilliant, and obviously playing in T20 in front of a full house is amazing, but I think that the skill that it takes to do well on red ball is probably, as a professional, is the real thing that you pride yourself on, kind of holy grail of being successful in red ball. And like, I've been really lucky in England that at Warwickshire I won the one day competition and I won the T20 blast, and I think that to be involved in a championship winning team would be really special, especially with the history that Yorkshire have got here, being the county that's won the most county championships. If you can play a very, very small part in that history, that's something that kind of gets me out of bed in the morning, I guess.
Super answer, I have to say. That's a really nice answer, Josh. Josh, I think that brings us to the end of the pod. Do you want to let our listeners know where they can find you on Instagram, where they can find your podcast, on Twitter? Just plug whatever you like.
So my personal handles are at JoshPoisden14 on Instagram and Twitter. And then the podcast that I've started, Spin Badgers, at Spin Badger on Instagram and Twitter. And then if you search for Spin Badger on iTunes, podcast, SoundCloud, Spotify, it's all on there. And, you know, for anyone who's any leg spinners or any spinners, they've got any questions, if they want to get in touch through the kind of Spin Badger socials, it's, you know, I've said in this interview, I've been really lucky to learn from some brilliant leg spinners. So if I can kind of hopefully pass on some of that knowledge, that was a big motivator for me starting my own podcast. So if anyone's got any questions, get in touch. And also, I guess, you know, big thanks, DJ, for having me on. Like I said, I've been to India a couple of times, and it's obviously, it's a very crazy place, but somewhere that I've always really enjoyed going. So thanks. Thanks, DJ.
No, thank you for giving us your time. It's been really nice chatting leg spin with you. I have to admit, I started life as a leg spinner. Didn't do very well at it because I got smashed everywhere in the nets as a 12-year-old. But thank you again so much for your time. It's been really nice speaking to you. And we will put all the links and things in the show notes. But hope to have you back again soon. And good luck with kind of all your future stuff, and see you soon.
Thanks, mate. Anytime I can do anything to help, DJ, just give me a shout.
Absolutely, mate. Cheers. Thank you. And there you have it, guys. A very interesting interview with Josh Poisden. As always, write in with your comments and feedback at contact@onetiponehand.com. We are on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. And guys, leave us a review. Leave us a review on Apple iTunes. It helps make us more visible. Leave us a rating. It takes like 2 seconds for you guys to do that, right? Or Stitcher or wherever you guys listen to this. And tell your friends about this podcast, man. I mean, we put it out every week. It's all about Indian cricket and the kind of important happenings all around the globe. It's a little bit of fun. It's a little bit of banter. We try to take ourselves not too seriously. We will see you next week, and that will be the Monty Panesar episode, and we'll have a little bit of an update because live cricket would have started by then. So stay tuned and keep enjoying the Edges and Sledges Cricket Podcast.
Hi, my name is Anupam Gupta. I'm B50 on Twitter. I am the host of Paisa Paisa, the show that talks money. On my show, I speak to experts from every field of money and finance, from stock markets, equities, debt funds, credit cards, life insurance, every possible area of money and finance that you can think of. We even did an episode on cryptocurrency. I've got fantastic guests from mutual funds to personal finance experts everywhere, robo-advisors, startups, just name it, we've got it. At Paisa Paisa, we help you make smart decisions about money. You work hard for money. Now make your money work hard for you. New episodes out every Monday, and you can listen to my show on the IVM Podcast app or any other podcasting app that you have.
Sachin Tendulkar, Virat Kohli, Don Bradman, and now Cyrus Brocha. Okay, probably not in the right company. I mean, Don Bradman is Australian. But it's called Cyrus Says, a wonderful show about everything. Find the show on the IVM Podcast app, ivmpodcast.com, or wherever you listen to podcasts.